on the ancient traditions of Doha. MotoGP has been racing on the Persian Gulf since 2004. The race for glory starts now. Time to crank up the volume in Qatar. It's time to race in MotoGP. It's been 20 years then this year since we first arrived at the LaSalle International Circuit in Qatar, always a popular stop-off on our world tour. The best race lap, Andrea Bastianini, is 152.978. Will that be beaten over 22 laps coming up later on tonight? Technical layout, fast and flying, particularly in the first and third sectors. 16 corners, 6 left, 10 right. Top speeds nudging 365 kilometres an hour down the 0.6 of a mile start-finish straight. Heavy braking into the first corner, overtaking opportunities into turn 6. Real fast sweeping run through turn number 11. Then that fast final sector, turns 15 and 16, one of three heavy braking points around this 5.3-kilometre LaSalle International Circuit. This was last year. Fabio Di Gianantonio on course for a shock and surprise victory to take the spoils 3.5 months ago through turn 12. Coming up next then in MotoGP. 10 sprint wins and counting as Jorge Martin looks to build an early championship lead. Can KTM conquer Qatar and show Brad Binder is one to watch as a title contender? Plenty of pace and potential. Aleix Espargaró wants to return to winning ways for Aprilia. And Pecco Bagnaia aims to fire some early momentum into his title defence. Good evening and welcome to the Qatar Airways Grand Prix of Qatar here at the LaSalle International Circuit. Race day number one of 21 in 2024. A special year for MotoGP, the 75th anniversary year. Last year it was Pecco Bagnaia who successfully defended the number one plate. But he's got big trouble brewing potentially from Jorge Martin once again in 2024. The Spaniard for Prima Pramac Racing, superb on Super Saturday yesterday as he took pole position and a start to finish sprint victory. He's the early pace setter in this year's MotoGP World Championship as the stage is set. The lights are on, off in the distance. Here's downtown Doha. Who's going to be heading back to Europe happiest tonight? 22 laps coming your way in the Premier Class. 8 p.m. local time will be the kickoff. Lights out and we'll be racing as we get set to start this 75th anniversary season. Race on the way then in about 40 minutes time. We've already had an incredible start to the season. Brilliant racing in Moto3 and in Moto2. A lot to live up to for the MotoGP riders. I'm sure they are up to the task though. Great to be back. Our traditional season opener, of course, here in Qatar. Hosted the FIFA Football World Cup in 2022. On the World Championship calendar since 2004, the 22nd Grand Prix here in the Persian Gulf. 18th under Qatar's spectacular night lights. MotoGP bigger, better and stronger than ever before. And there's a special grid ceremony taking place here as we embark on this landmark 75th anniversary season. Dignitaries, Dorna CEO Carmelo Espeleta, of course, in the middle of your picture there. FIM President George Viejas, joined by team bosses and team principals from all 11 of our MotoGP teams. On the far left there, of course, Gigi Delina. Can Ducati continue their domination of the MotoGP World Championship in 2024? Honda and Yamaha playing catch-up. Lynn Jarvis there, having a little joke with Massimo Rivola, the Aprilia boss. All the fun of the fair in downtown Doha right now. Well, who's going to be having all the fun and enjoying opening night the most here in Qatar? There is Pit Beirer, KTM Motorsport Director. Strong start last night for the Red Bull KTM Factory Racing team. Brad Binder in second place. Bringing you all the build-up and the race coverage at 8 p.m. local time here in Qatar. Matt Burt and Lewis Sutterby in the commentary box. It's Simon Crafar down in pit lane. Just saw there as well Justin Marks. We welcome a brand new team, of course, into the MotoGP World Championship this year. Welcome along, enjoy the ride, Trackhouse Racing. It's going to be very special indeed. Paolo Campinotti last night was the happiest team boss on that Photoshop because his rider did the business. Start to finish victory for Jorge Martin in the 11 lap Tissot sprint last night, which Brad Binder described as an insane pace. We were only here, weren't we, for the penultimate round of 2023, 3.5 months ago, last November. Jorge Martin last night, this was the moment he took the checkered flag. This sprint was 11 seconds faster than the sprint last November. The first gold medal of the season going the way of Jorge Martin. Very much the sprint king of 2023, was he? 9 sprint wins. The perfect 10 now for Martin. Normal service resumed in the Tissot sprint. And it's all eyes on the rookie sensation. The Shark looks anything but a rookie, doesn't he, at the moment? Pedro Acosta Lewis, he really did light up the sail last night. 8th place on debut in the sprint, 4.4 seconds away from the victory. Such an explosive, impressive debut from Acosta. He's going to be in the hunt again for the top 6 tonight.
Well, we were already so excited about Pedro Acosta on his introduction to MotoGP, but boy, is he already living up to the hype. This was in his very first practice session on Friday afternoon, having this save through turn number 1. That was one of about 3 or 4 that he had over the course of that session, a session that he ended inside the top 3. He is born for the stage of MotoGP. He's just got the character for it. He's got the bravado for it. And he's just got the skill and talent for it. No question about that. As we watch Aleix Espargaró walk into the Aprilia box, many tipping him for a tilt at victory later on this evening. So how high are the hopes within Aprilia Racing? Let's hear from Paolo Bonoro, who's downstairs with Simon. No,
He is. Other people wishing him well as well tonight. Paolo, I heard from many riders at debriefs last night, super impressed how fast Aleix was later part in the race, you know, managing that rear tyre, the corner speed of the Aprilia. Do you feel as confident as the people from the outside do about Aleix's win tonight?
Well, saying like this is quite difficult at the moment, Simon, but seeing what he did yesterday, we are confident that he can manage the tire also during this long race. For sure, he did a very good job, very, very good job, because he was studying the situation, he was studying what will happen to the rear tire. At the end, he managed so well, so he continued to have stability until the last laps. Unfortunately, there was no more lap to achieve another position, but it was an unbelievable result for us, and we are happy about the job that Aleix did. In Maverick side, we found something. For sure, to be honest, during the warm-up, during this night and during the warm-up, We study what happened yesterday during the race. To be fully honest, he did a very good race pace, despite of the position in grid. So it was a key for sure to start in that part of the grid was not helpful. And this morning we found something, and we hope that we have raising up a little bit his confidence on the bike. We say to him to manage carefully the tire also in his side, because it will be a key in this race.
Paolo, thank you for your time. Really, we wish you luck.
Thanks so much, Simon. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks to Paolo Bonora. Thanks to Simon Crafar. Yeah, you do feel it was a correct assessment. Spot on. Aleix Espargaró probably just needed one more lap and he would have reeled in Martin and Binder ahead of him. 34 years of age now, of course, isn't he? The Spanish rider going from second on the grid. We just saw Pecco Bagnaia then walking into the back of the factory Ducati garage. He starts the defence of his title. And this man was very impressive last night, wasn't he, on his first sprint appearance for Ducati. Marc Marquez taking the checkered flag in fifth place. 1.8 seconds he was off the win. Felt like maybe, understandably so as well, though it's maybe a little bit tentative in the first lap in particular. Of course, it was the first time he'd really got into gung-ho attack mode in a race scenario on the Ducati. An early joust with the Gian Antonio and his brother Alex Marquez cost him a little bit of time, but once he found his groove, once he found his rhythm, as we said last night, an abundance of positives for Marc Marquez.
Well, we saw that big smile on his face after his very first run on board a Ducati back at the Valencia test in November. We saw a similar smile on his face when he came into the box at Gresini last night, having taken that fifth place. A satisfactory start, I would say, for Marc Marquez on board that Gresini Ducati. He did always say throughout testing that he felt that getting an outright time attack out of this Ducati was less of a problem than his race pace. So perhaps this is the part of the weekend where we're likely to see the best out of Marc Marquez on board that Gresini Ducati. We're expecting it to maybe take two or three races, or that's certainly what the team are telling us, for Marc Marquez to get the best out of the Ducati. But I think we might be able to see a bit better from him in an early stage. He seems like he's right there in the mix.
Brad Binder capitalised on this stunning start right at the start of last night's sprint. Wasn't quite enough though to defeat the man directly ahead of him. Martin making the whole shot, and that was all she wrote really. Brad Binder, he really did put up a ferocious challenge for that second place, but it's another sprint podium for Binder. He says that that KTM has come on leaps and bounds. Corner entry and braking, it's night and day difference between the RC16 from last year. Solid, rock solid start from Binder. Silver medal for him to kick off 2024. Let's go back down to pit lane then. Simon Crafar.
He's down with Davide Brivio from the Trackhouse team. Simon, down to you.
Yes, Davide, I had to welcome you back for the first race. So good to have you here. Also from a selfish point of view, because it's always good to hear your comments, you know, and you don't hide from us. So, Davide, I'm curious. I mean, it's going to take a while for your influence, you know, like always, whether it's an engineer or a team manager and that. So I'm not going to bother you about that. But I'm curious if you believe that your riders can take advantage of what we're seeing Aleix do, like meaning over race distance, this longer one. It looks like the Aprilia is pretty good at managing the rear tyre. I'm sure that's partly Aleix as well. What are your feelings?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, because we have seen yesterday, of course, Aleix having also a performance quite different compared to the other. But we were able to make some adjustment now, and which we think we can improve yesterday, we think. Then I will tell you later. We think we can improve the performance from yesterday. It's very encouraging to see, of course, Aleix race, how he could manage with the tire, and how the Aprilia was in a good situation compared to the others after a few laps. So we hope, and also we can go in a good direction. And Raul and Miguel, they had a good pace. Raul also is quite confident, but yesterday there was a bad start, and so the start, of course, you know, it's very important, and maybe many things come from there. But yeah, we made some adjustment on both sides, and let's see.
Davide, thank you and best of luck. First race with Trackhouse.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm very excited and very happy to be here. A great welcome from everybody, so let's get started.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Thanks to Davide Brivio. What an addition, a real statement of intent, isn't it, about how serious Trackhouse Racing are about establishing themselves as major contenders, major players in this MotoGP World Championship. Great to see Davide Brivio back, of course, a title-winning team manager with Yamaha and with Suzuki. Can he make it a hat-trick? Although there's a little bit of a footnote to remind you of, yeah. A legacy of last November. We just saw a replay of it. But on the very first lap of the Tissot Sprint, Miguel Oliveira, unfortunately, clattering into the back of Aleix Espargaró. Miguel Oliveira actually missed the end of the season after suffering a fractured right shoulder blade. And the carry-on is he will have to serve a long lap penalty in tonight's 22-lap Qatar Grand Prix. So just a little reminder there that Oliveira will come through the long lap penalty after that indiscretion 3 months ago.
Yeah, he must be the first rider in MotoGP history to serve a penalty for something he did at the previous year's corresponding Grand Prix. A quirk of last year's calendar, of course, with the Qatar Grand Prix not starting 2023 as they renovated the circuit. 2022, of course, saw this man take victory. The first of two consecutive Grassini wins here under the lights at Lasalle. Enea Bastianini out qualifying his teammate Pecco Bagnaia in the opening round of the season. He starts on the outside of the front row. He did say on Thursday that he's been looking to try and change his mental approach to try and get a little bit more out of himself on those time attacks and in the Tissot Sprint. Of course, we saw generally the best from Enea Bastianini the longer races go on, so this might be the kind of scenario where we see the best of the beast. He'll certainly be hoping to improve on a underwhelming, I guess you could say, sixth place last night.
He called it an unusual sprint from lap four onwards. He said he had a rear vibration which made the bike feel quite unstable, particularly in the fast turn, which is not something you want to have around this LaSalle circuit. 50th MotoGP start for the beast here tonight. Of course, he set the chain of events in motion, the wheels in motion for Grassini's current domination of MotoGP here in Qatar. Last couple of years, he won in 2022. The Gian Antonio was the winner here last November. So it's on the shoulders of the Marquez brothers to try and make it the hat trick here.
Well, we just looked into the Mooney VR46 box. We're now looking at Marco Bezzecchi, and just outside, Pablo Nieto is waiting to speak to Simon. Over to you.
He is. Before the race, I wanted to get your thoughts, Pablo. Two different things on the side of the garage there. Is, first of all, DG, Fabio De Gennantonio, on form, like all through winter testing. He's basically picked up from last year looking from the outside, but a strange crash in the race, after a bit of a fight with Marc Marquez. On the other side of the garage, I'd like your thoughts, because a lot of us love Bez, what he achieved last year, how he is, and it looks like he's having a tough time with the GP23.
Yeah, with DJ we make a fantastic job during the all-winter test, so I think we can make a very good job together. Yesterday he had that crash that it was a little bit strange, but he made a mistake with the gearbox, and that was because of the crash. But I think today also, if he managed in the good way the tires, I think he can make a very good race. In the other side with Marco, it's true that all winter we had some problems. This bike is completely different from last year, so we still have to improve a little bit. It's true that this morning we make one step, so this is very good, but I'm still thinking that we are missing some time. So, but at the moment it's good to go in the right way.
Thank you, Pablo. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Thanks to Pablo Nieto. Yeah, big whack on the left foot in that horrible crash last night in the sprint for number 49, Fabio De Gennantonio, who really caused one of the big shocks of last season when he won here last November. Some fans roaring on this man. The world champion last night said happy with the points, a fourth place, not what he wanted. 1.6 seconds off the win, certainly not happy with his feeling. Plonked on top of that factory Ducati, completely different, he said, to the test. He was lacking rear grip, had to change his riding style even in that short 11 lap sprint to try and find some punch off the corners. I was a bit worried about a quite a sharp increase in front and rear tyre temperature, which is quite unusual. We hear when riders are in a group, they've got sort of worries about front tyre temperature and pressure, but certainly not the rear. But several riders last night in that sprint did mention the fact that they were hindered somewhat by a rear chatter and rear vibration. And there, Bastianini, Jorge Martin actually touched upon it as well. Even though he did dominate from start to finish, he did say it wasn't without those chatter gremlins, which sort of followed him throughout the pre-season test here a couple of weeks ago and throughout this weekend.
Well, it's fair to say we haven't seen the best of Bagnaia in sprints as of late. He hasn't won a Tiso sprint since Austria back in the summer of last season. And fairness, Jorge Martin has won 90% of those that we've seen since then. But Bagnaia tends to produce his best on a Sunday night. Remember here, back in November, as Marco Bezzecchi is giving our back cam a wave, a new innovation for 2024. Remember last year when Jorge Martin took the sprint victory and closed the gap on Pecco Bagnaia? Bagnaia went from fifth on the grid in the Sunday night race, as he does tonight, and he led into turn one.
Yeah, you do feel back cam for Marco Bezzecchi, back against the wall as well at the moment, as Pablo Nieto alluded to. Michelin tyre allocation then for this opening Grand Prix. Front soft, medium and hard, as is per usual in the allocation. And two rear options, the soft and the medium. Medium rear tyre is asymmetric. That's always a wonderful sight, isn't it? A spectacular sight. A sight we've been having the pleasure of witnessing since Qatar created history all the way back in 2008, when it became the first ever MotoGP circuit to host a night race. Still the only MotoGP circuit to host a night race. And it just feels like, yeah, there's that sort of extra special vibe, a special feeling of anticipation and expectation when it's round one here in Qatar. Of course, we came late in November, because there was a massive, impressive, multi-million pound revamp of the facilities here. I talk about state of the art. It's a wonderful paddock, the upgraded facilities. Now that we know, the Japanese manufacturer, we just listened there to Jorge Martin coming to the grid at the slowest possible speed with fuel conservation in mind. The Japanese factories, after a woeful 2023, are playing catch-up, aren't they? Particularly Yamaha, who were winless last year for the first time in 20 years. 12th place for Fabio Quartararo in the sprint last night, 17th for Alex Rins. Some issues with rear grip as well. A tough night, you feel, in prospect for the Iwata factory. Let's get some thoughts of their boss, Massimo Marugali, who joins Simon.
He does. Massimo, a lot of things I want to ask you. We don't have much time, but basically, I really thought Yamaha had made improvements in most areas, and Fabio thought the same. Then last night was a tough one, like tyre consumption by the sounds for a lot of people, but it sounds like especially your riders. Is it this circuit? Will it get better from here? And what do you expect tonight?
Yeah, first of all, I would like to say that it's a bit frustrating starting the season in this way. We aimed for something else. We were quite satisfied about the improvement we have done during the winter. We saw how the test went in Sepang and also here. So the expectations were a bit different, even if we are aware that it will take time to be realistic and objective. It takes time to be back being competitive as we would like. But yesterday, the race, a part of the tire drop that we already saw that during the simulation we did in the test. But yesterday, we have to say that the sprint race was 11 seconds quicker than last year. And also our one was almost 6 seconds faster than last year. It means that the rider pushed more. And we compare last year versus yesterday, and we noticed that the temperature of the tire were higher. The rider pushed more. So the only area where we work from yesterday is just to explain the rider how they should try to manage the tire. We also modify some settings, electronic setting, to help help them to try to avoid this really hot temperature, because we, in any case, we expect a drop, but we would like to get this drop later as possible.
Mayo, thank you for your time. Good luck.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Thanks to Mayo Maragai. We're just running through the starting grid here, and we can see on the first four rows, this is coming to the grid, early Mitchell information. In fact, at the moment, the top 18 riders out of 22 starting this Grand Prix, well, there's no split choices. Medium front, medium rear tyres throughout. Well, there's one slight deviation. And that was Taka Nakagami there, who's gone for the soft front tyre. Everybody else on the medium front, medium rear. Is that a shark that's been erected, especially for Pedro Acosta's MotoGP debut? The neon lights of downtown Doha. You cannot imagine how much the landscape of this city has changed since we first came here 20 years ago, back in 2004.
Feels like it changes every year.
Yeah, it feels like it changes every year. It is a shark downtown and a shark ready to rock here in MotoGP. Pedro Acosta, he's got a brilliant little learner plate on the back of his helmet as well.
Won't last long.
He's certainly a fast learner, as we have seen. This is a game changer for him. This is a complete new ball game. He's never been in this kind of high pressure, high tension situation with so much at stake, as the Qatar Armed Forces Regiment Band come to the grid, ready for the national anthem, which should be getting underway in just under 10 minutes time. So Pedro Acosta, 8th place he was in the sprint on his Red Bull GasGas Tech 3 debut. Looking very chilled, very relaxed under the night light. It's a little kiss there for his wife Laura, Aleix Espargaró. Who are we to argue with Marc Márquez? Márquez said last night, well, Aleix Espargaró is the favourite. He's got such good rear grip, managing the worn tyres in that factory of Aprilia. We'll find out very shortly if Mark's been spot on with that assessment.
He was clearly the strongest rider at the end of the Tissot sprint, as he caught Brad Binder at a fast rate in Oz, but just ran out of laps, as Paolo Bonora told us. The corner speed of the Aprilia was unmatched, as he passed Pecco Bagnaia in particular. So if Aprilia can extend that kind of performance over double the distance, then you'd imagine they'll be in good shape when the race reaches its conclusion.
Congratulations to all concerned here at the LaSalle International Circuit, because it was here as we came for the 19th year in 2023 that the Qatar Grand Prix was voted the best of 2023. A thoroughly deserved prize, a special prize-giving ceremony on the grid then as we head into the first race. So congratulations to everybody connected to the LaSalle International Circuit. I can't believe it's 20 years since we first came here back in 2004. A race which was won back in the daytime then, of course, by Sete Gibernau. A race that took place in September when it was considerably hotter in Doha, as Johan Zarco prepares for his debut on the LCR Honda. Beautiful livery for me. A winner of the best livery contest in 2023. Last night, positive signs that KTM have put a proper competitive weapon underneath Brad Binder for this season. He was second in the sprint. Huge hopes that they can sustain a title challenge throughout this season. Let's get some thoughts from KTM Motorsport board director Pit Beyer, who's with Simon.
He is, Pit. Tonight is very hard to predict because we know there's going to be a big tyre drop over race distance. There was a drop last night at half distance. So I think if you managed to find a way to give Brad what he was asking for last night when he mentioned it in his debrief, you know, some help rear tyre wise, I think he can fight for the win. Do you?
Well, I mean, last night it was half a second missing after 11 laps on the finish line, so that's not huge. I mean, exactly what you said, he asked, give me something, just a little bit on the rear, I need something and then I can do the job. But Everybody, I think, is aware that the tire management will be crucial in this race, so it's double than yesterday. So I don't know what to say. I feel like performance-wise, we are ready. Brad definitely is ready. But yeah, tire management will be crucial. So we prefer to push like crazy, but today I think it's not the hardest pusher who will win the race. It's more the guy who can control the tire. And let's see what Pedro does. Looks like he has so many things natural in his body. Let's see how he will treat his tire, and maybe he can have a little better start, because yesterday he didn't unlock the start hook. He didn't brake hard enough into the first turn because he was a bit cautious. And so also from him, I don't know, we're going to see something special from him also today. So yeah, let's just go racing now.
Pit, thanks for your time. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Simon. Thanks to Pit Byra. There is downtown Doha, as we get ready then for the build-up, the final countdown to the opening Grand Prix of the season. Great to see Stefano Domenicali here, a Formula One boss, popping over from Saudi Arabia, where they were racing last night. Another runaway success for Red Bull's Max Verstappen. Are we going to get a Red Bull victor here tonight? Big hopes resting on the shoulders of Brad Binder.
Well, Liano, who's good friends with Jorge Martin, we saw them sharing a word earlier on in the weekend. He might be looking to cheer his friend on to success later on tonight. It will be a tall order for Alex Rins to taste success here this evening. Here he is, ready for his Yamaha debut, going from 20th on the grid. He, like Fabio Quartararo, ran into some real rear tyre problems late in the sprint, which will no doubt be concerning the Spaniard with double the distance lying ahead of him this evening.
Qatar Grand Prix 2022, Grosjean Racing won an emotional success with Andrea Bastianini. Qatar Grand Prix 2023, Grosjean Racing won with Fabio Di Antonio. Does the hat trick beckon? Let's go and get some pre-race thoughts of Grosjean Racing boss Michele Messini, who joins Simon.
Yes, he does. I'm a bit excited to speak to Michele. Both your riders, Marquez, brothers. And I was thinking about tonight's race, listening to Mark's debrief last night. Fifth last night, you know, first time on the Ducati. I believe tonight that he could put it on the podium. Do you?
Yeah, let me say that yesterday we broke the ice on the race with Mark. We studied a lot yesterday night how we can modify, how we can be better. We see something in the riding style. Also, I think we try something on the bike that maybe we will work well, but we see. For sure, we have to make a good start and be calm in the first laps.
Thank you. Good luck.
Yeah, welcome. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. Thanks to Michele Messini. They have enjoyed unrivaled success here in Qatar over the last couple of years. Marc Marquez. He said he wanted the Ducati challenge, he wanted the smile back on his face. Well, it was certainly all across his face last night after that brilliant fifth place. Can he be the first Ducati rider to win on debut since Casey Stoner did so right here in Qatar to kick off the 800cc era back in 2007?
So a rather chilled looking Marco Bezzecchi at the moment, but he's also got a long way to move to get towards the front of this race. To be fair, he's not got much change out of Qatar in his last two visits. Qualified way down the field last year in 13th, which is where he finished both the sprint and the Grand Prix. And having missed out in qualifying one yesterday afternoon, he was not able to make his way any further forward than 11th place. So Marco Bezzecchi still pointless as this season gets underway.
Let's go down quickly before we get the national anthem underway to Ducati Novo team boss Davide Tardozzi for some pre-race thoughts.
Davide, always good to hear your thoughts. And tonight, it feels like you've got your work cut out for you. You know, your two awesome riders on your awesome machines. Because it's not going to be as simple as just being the fastest, is it? Tell us your thoughts.
Yeah, with the experience of yesterday, we know that we need to manage the tire wear of the rear tire. So we'll see, because everybody had suffering or had the same problem, that is chattering. So at the mid of the sprint race. So that means that for the long race will be really a big issue to manage. So we'll see who will manage better, but I think that the race will be a bit slower than yesterday, but after 12, 14 laps, I think that we can understand who will be able to fight for the podium.
Thank you, Davide.
Thank you.
Thanks, Simon. Thanks, WTyre.se. Yeah, the Yamahas in particular suffered the most, it seemed, from that rear tyre drop-off in the sprint last night. Alex Rins said he expected a tough sprint. That's exactly what he got. Suffering with a lack of rear grip from lap five onwards. Jack Miller made up a lightning bolt start, didn't he? Coming through to fifth early on, and then there was an electronics gremlin. Seemed to be the anti-wheelie wasn't really working as it should have done throughout the sprint last night, and Jack was just getting massive wheelie coming out the corners, of course, which just cuts all of your drive coming out the corner. So he's a bit of a passenger at times on that KTM RC16, was the Australian, as we build towards them. The national anthem here, head of the Qatar Airways Grand Prix of Qatar. You can just sense, even though the most experienced riders on the grid like Marc Marquez, they will be feeling the nerves. There'll be butterflies in the stomach. So imagine what's going through the mind right now of a rookie like Pedro Acosta, 19 years old ahead of his MotoGP debut. Here we go then for the Qatari national anthem.
قسما 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 بمن رفع السماء قسما بمن نشر الضياء قطر ستبقى حرة تسمو بروح الأوفياء سيروا على نهج الأولى سيروا وعلى ضياء الأنبياء قطر عز وأمجاد الإباء قطر الرجال الأولين حماتنا يوم النداء وحمائم يوم السلام جوارح يوم الفداء قسما 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 بمن رفع السماء قسما بمن نشر الضياء قطر ستبقى حرة تسمو بروح الأوفياء
A great performance then of the Qatari national anthem there from Nasser Al-Khabesi, and supported brilliantly by the Qatar Armed Forces Regiment Band. Dignitaries then will leave the grid very, very shortly. Special anniversary season of MotoGP, 75th anniversary. Of course, our 20th year coming here to Doha. And splendid buildings like that, trust me, we're not here back in 2004. You can just get the feeling, can't you, now that the tension really is being ramped up. Jorge Martin, full focus, full concentration. Pecco Bagnaia. In the previous history of Grand Prix motorcycle racing, rich heritage, rich history dating back to 1949, there have been only nine riders that have successfully won three successive Premier Class titles. Jeff Duke, John Surtees, Mike Hailwood, Giacomo Agostini, Kenny Roberts, Wayne Rainey, Mick Doohan, Valentino Rossi and Marc Marquez, some of the best to ever do it in Grand Prix motorcycle racing. And Pecco Bagnaia could join that exclusive club. So then, Jorge Martin, pole and the sprint win last night. Can he make it yet another treble? Trebles in Misano and Motegi in Buriram last year. Let's get some thoughts from Prima Pramac Racing boss Gino Borsoy is with Simon.
He is, Gino. Actually, we're further down the grid, standing with his other rider, Franco Morbidelli. Let's hope Franco comes back soon, you know, no testing and all that. But how fast was Jorge Martin last night? Tonight is a different game. Can you tell us your thoughts?
Oh, for sure, different game, different situation. We were struggling yesterday a lot with, again, with the chattering. We test different setup this morning during the warm-up, but didn't work. So I'm not sure about the result of today. You know, yesterday we got the good result because the rider was so fast, not because the bike was good. And let's see. Everybody have more or less the same problem in Ducati. So from the middle to the end, everybody have to fighting. But I know we have an incredible rider, so he can manage.
Thank you, Gino.
Thank you.
They certainly do have an incredible rider, don't they, with Jorge Martin. He's led them at a GP World Championship before when he won the sprint in Mandalika, but it was a short-lived affair. Led it for 24 laps before that costly error when he was 3 seconds clear of Maverick Vinales in Lombok. Never retained the World Championship lead since. So can he hold on to the title lead for a little bit longer than that? Alex Espargaro then. Does more silverware, another trophy beckon for Aprilia's captain. Got to say, out of all the riders on the grid here at the moment, I suppose he's got the experience, age 34, and this is his 322nd Grand Prix start. Alex Espargaro looks like the most relaxed out of everybody.
Yeah, he's got that air of calm about him. This is one time of the weekend, and certainly one time of the season, where there will be very few calm heads on that grid. Jorge Martin trying to get himself in the zone, and hopefully not with the memories of his start to last year's Qatar Grand Prix, which went completely wrong. The shark zone of Pedro Acosta, who's ready to swim with the nastiest sharks in motorcycle racing. There's one of them. Marc Marquez all set for his Gresini debut over the full race distance. So many ingredients as to why this should be a cracking start to our 75th anniversary MotoGP season. 22 laps lie ahead of us as we decide the first winner of 2024.
Acosta, he's swimming now with the big fish, isn't he? No question. Alongside each other on the front row of that grid. They're buzzing buddies, aren't they? Great pals from a long, long way back. Aleix Espargaró actually was influential, helping out in the early part of Jorge Martin's career. They're almost like brothers, really. They spend so much time together, training camps, pre-season, to get themselves in the shape of their lives. Ahead of our longest season in Grand Prix history. 21 races, 17 countries. Fabio Quartararo, you wouldn't be parting with too much of your hard-earned. For him to repeat his success here in Qatar 2021, it was a really difficult sprint last night for Quartararo. Massimo Maragalli saying that, of course, they did improve by 6 seconds compared to the sprint last November. Ducati, though, were 11 seconds faster. KTM, 16 seconds faster. Aprilia, 14 seconds faster. European manufacturers' iron grip on MotoGP remains so far in 2024. Honda and Yamaha, of course, benefiting from what they hope will be performance-enhancing concessions. Your first front row of the grid, though, in 2024. Anea Bastianini, a former Qatar Grand Prix winner here a couple of years ago in 2022. Aleix Espargaró, the oldest rider in the MotoGP field. He's like a good old red wine. Gets better with age, doesn't he, Aleix? Can he take Aprilia's first win here in Qatar? But on pole position, the pole and sprint winner last night, Jorge Martin, goes from pole in Qatar.